What's up, Call of Duty fans? Welcome back to Checkmate Gaming, or welcome for the first time, as this is our first debut video of me kind of joining the team on a more regular basis. And with that, we've got challengers to talk about. How about that? First time we've gotten a real good look at every single region in Call of Duty Challengers with the start of our 50K series, which will span across individual regionalized tournaments in APAC, or Asia Pacific, Europe, and as well, of course, North America. Now, if you haven't been following along with the challenger scene, it's been a little bit of a weird ride so far for a lot of these teams because of the COVID-19 situation. All of the homestand events kind of went away, and the question mark was, would there be anything of substance for Challengers players to play in? The answer we got as of recently was definitively yes. So with Challengers, you're going to expect two different types of formats to come through. The first will be every single weekend that there is a CDL event, there will be a Challengers event for 10,000 points, as far as I understand. And of course, a pretty hefty money value when it comes to if you finish near the top. But on weekends that there are not CDL events, you're going to start seeing these 50K cups pop up, where a lot more lion's share of prize money will be distributed between the top squads, and a chance for these guys to be broadcasted, which is what a lot of people have been going for. So as we dig into these style of videos, I'll be giving you guys recaps of who's done well, what it's looking like in all of the regions, and what you might be able to look forward to as we continue to see these events pop up for challengers. So let's dig into it and look at APAC first. Now, before we talk about final results, I will just go ahead and mention the simple fact of there is a two-stage format for these tournaments. Open entry for anyone to participate in. You can find the information on callofduty.com/challengers as far as where the signups and enrollments will be happening for these tournaments. The open entry will come down to the first day of action, always being single elimination, until you get to the top eight. Once you get to the top eight, the tournament will stop for the day, and going into the second day, the tournament will move to a double elimination style. So essentially what you're looking to do, day number one, get to the top eight. Day number two, that's when the heat really picks up in the kitchen. And in APAC, well, let's be candid. There usually are not eight solid candidates to get into what would be that second stage because the scene has been mostly dominated by four or five squads. As we move through that double elimination style bracket, our broadcast only brought us the finals, but here were our final four that were in the mix. Renegades will play up against Mind Freak, a battle of what has been the best in the winner's finals, time and time again. In the loser semis, Hawaii Nation will be playing up against Rift Nation. Notably again, no Liblent Vertex, no Rush Gaming, they weren't able to make it this far. But getting through this first round, it went almost as expected all the way through. Renegades, who have been beating Mind Freak continually, would be able to do that here in a 3-1 total. And on the bottom side, a very tight best of five. It wasn't live broadcasted, but a number of the players were streaming. A very good best of five that went all the way to five, where Rift Nation would eventually win the Search and Destroy 3-2. So we'd get Mind Freak versus Rift Nation in the Losers Finals, and Renegades awaiting the winner of that. Again, APAC has been heavily dominated by just Renegades and Mind Freak. That would continue to be the case here as Mind Freak would find a relatively convincing 3-0 versus Rift Nation in that loser's finals, sending them to a rematch versus Renegades. And again, the result here would be just as we expected it, as it's been mostly throughout the entirety of the year. Renegades, who hold a very high placement average in APAC, have not had many problems with Mind Freak. They wouldn't again here as it was a 3-1 total. Relatively close throughout a couple of moments, but generally speaking, this Renegades team is just that much better. Krimza, Fida, Pred, Setsi, and Swifty. After Tainted Minds kind of broke up, after the guys from Mind Freak last year got picked up to the CDL, this Renegades team found the five best players in APAC, in my opinion. They put them together onto one team, then they look relatively solid. Again, this was a squad that finished sixth at Minnesota, whereas Mind Freak finished top 12. Not bad performances from either teams, to be sure, but again, sitting in APAC, maybe not getting the same kind of practice as they would have wanted to with the land environment that was hopefully going to be there. They're still looking very, very strong. So Renegades would find their way through this, which would lead us into the next side of the bracket, which would be Europe. Now, again, for the way the broadcast coverage went, it was simply, again, just as games were coming, they were broadcasting. So what does that 100% mean for Europe? Again, same format all the way through. Top eight teams would qualify. You had War, Obtained, BDS, Voltage Esport, Train Hard, BBC's Afro, Tech 10 Gaming, and the Canucks, which was formerly the Royal Ravens Academy. As we dug through the tournament, we would get to our Final Four, which looked like Team War going up against the Canucks, obtained playing up against Team BDS. Now, again, Singularity is one of those squads that has been doing very well in Europe, but they're actually currently staying in North America, and they've been participating in all of the North American scenes. So, again, like APAC, there has been a little bit of a hierarchy when it comes to what the usual European standings look like. This time through, War, Royal Ravens Academy, now known as the Canucks, they have been definitively the top two squads. In the mix has been BDS and Trainhard and Obtained and Elitist. Those have been the other three teams that have routinely been through, but Elitist this time would actually not qualify for a top eight spot as they lost to Tech 10. So there's a lot of things going on, but let's start off with our first round of this championship bracket. The Canucks versus Team War. This has been a matchup that has been very close in the past, and it would continue to be here as we'd see it go to four games. War staying in it pretty much all the way through, but simply put, the Canucks squad with Nasty and the rest of the game that was, again, like I mentioned, playing under Royal Ravens Academy was just looking like they were going to be unstoppable today, at least in this matchup. Their outslaying potential was just that much higher than Team War, and with that, they found a way to take that first series. And on the bottom side, again, just like in APAC, our 3-4 teams, BDS and Obtained, we're at a tight one all the way through. This BDS squad, I won't lie to you, has been relatively unexpected for me. This is a team that is mostly made out of French players. You've got Zeke Natche, who I'm sure you're familiar with when they played last year in the overtime squad, and as well through denial at a certain point in time. But Zach and Usel, we have not seen a lot of. And how about this kid, Depa? Brand new to competing this year, he has taken the French scene by storm, and with that, he's been providing a lot of reputation to his own name based on how well he's played over the course of his young career so far in Modern Warfare, but unfortunately, he wouldn't fully be able to get the job done. Obtained, again, with a lot of players that were so close to making the Pro League last year in Nile and Brain, and you got Vortex who joined the CDL late. They were able to take it in five, which would pin them up against Team War in the losers' finals. And simply put, this Team War squad, just too good for Obtained. Again, we are really getting a look as far as the European scene is starting to separate just a touch. The one thing that Europe has going for it is the simple fact that teams like Obtained and BDS are sticking together. And with that, they're getting better and better every single week. But as of right now, they're still not at the level of Team War or this Canucks squad. So Team War would take it 3-1 and put them into a rematch grand finals versus the Canucks. But simply put, this matchup was tight all the way through it, including a domination that would go to a draw. A brilliant play from War as they had about 30 seconds left. They could have maybe played for a neutral to win the game. They did the math, realized, hey, if we hold on to our flags, we don't get too risky, we can force a draw and we can force a reset of the map. That would happen the second time around. Just as close as the first. Team War would go down early, but the Canucks, they would not be able to find a very solid second half, leading us to a point where War could potentially take a late surge to either get the win or, at the worst, draw. This time through, though, there would just not be enough room in the time bank to allow the draws, as the Canucks would take it by 1 point. And eventually, though, Team War would take map 4 at a very close scoreline. And then again, map 5 would go in their favor. We've got ourselves a bracket reset. Could Team War do what they did to Singularity at Paris and send a first best of 5 through all 5 maps and then come back to win the second best of 5? It wouldn't happen this time. The Canucks would make the adjustments they needed to. Again, this former Royal Ravens Academy team is looking absolutely insane. Madcat, Wee Man, Nolson, Nasty, and Lenny would find themselves their first championship this year and be essentially king the champions of Europe. And that now brings us to North America. And I will tell you flat out that the North American scene is going to be impossible to predict. Right now, I think there are 12 solid teams that could win this tournament any single day of the week. But alas, only one can win. So taking a look at our championship bracket, Singularity would play up against Steve Is Old. This was the former Six Gear squad that was playing during the Dallas event. And then you had Triumph going up against the Atlanta FaZe Academy in the losers bracket. But again, this was tight all the way through. A number of game fives all the way back to round number 1. Anything could have happened, and anybody any given day, I think, can win. Let's start with Singularity and Steve Isold. The Singularity team has been in a gauntlet so far, not only because they were doing well in Europe and then saw their success kind of dwindle, but they come to America to play in the homestand events. Those all get canceled, but they are getting significant amount of time scrimming and playing up against the best players in North America. They quickly realized that what they were winning with in Europe was not working in North America. Insight, who I thought was personally a top five AR period in the game, he actually gives up that role to Maple just of a couple of weeks ago. So the role swap has really kind of hindered Singularity's continued success. But was it going to be a situation where it was a couple of steps backwards and a multitude of steps forward? The answer would be definitively yes. Their engagements are higher. Their efficiency in their gunfights are much higher. They're looking much, much better than they were previously. So in this battle versus Steve Isold, Awakening and crew had been looking good all day long, but Singularity would take it 3-0. And on the bottom side, this Triumph team, who were the defending champions of the Dallas home series, would find a way to go 3-1 versus a very strong Atlanta FaZe Academy team. So in the losers finals, it would be Steve Isold going up against Triumph, and you'd have Singularity awaiting the winner of that in the grand finals. It was a tight one. It went four. Steve Isold would look very good all the way through. And again, this Triumph team impressed the living daylights out of me when I had a chance to watch them play at Dallas. Fellow and the rest of those veterans have found two very good up-and-coming players in Standy and Dave Patty. They look great. Dave played out of his mind, but it wasn't going to be enough, as Awakening and Willett and the rest of the guys of Steve Isold would be able to take the series in a close, very, very close, 3-1. That would send us to the grand finals, a rematch from the winners finals. And I'm telling you, this former Six Gear squad, they played well all the way through the regular bracket in stage one. A lot of people were saying that Awakening was looking nasty, and he absolutely was. But Singularity's adjustments have come through. They looked great in the Zir Cave. They looked great in the Search and Destroy. But it wouldn't be enough for them to definitively take this series versus Steve Isold. A lot of good battling back coming out of this experienced roster of this former Six Gear team. But at the end, it would not be enough for them to overcome Singularity. It would take five, but Singularity would close things out and become your first multi-regional champion, having won in Europe and now having won a major event, major online event, I should say, in North America. So with that, Singularity is your champion, the Kinects are your champions out of Europe, and you've got Renegades still holding things down in APAC. So coming up next, it will be the Chicago home series. We will be doing power rankings to list all of the CDL teams. We will be doing a look at what the bracket could potentially look like for the CDC. And for all of you guys that are out there playing in the Fantasy League, make sure you don't miss Fantasy Now, where I'll be breaking down all of your best performers and your best options to start going into the Chicago home series. Again, this has been awesome to be able to do this all on Checkmate Gaming. If you enjoy the content, please make sure you subscribe, ring that notification bell to know when our videos pop up, and make sure you stop by and check out the scene that's going on in Valorant, as we have a lot of live streams planned for the week on our live Twitch at twitch.tv/cmg_esports. And until the next time we see each other, hope you keep holding it down. So long.